Good afternoon and welcome to the Heritage Foundation and our Lewis Lehrman Auditorium. As we do prepare to begin, we would ask everyone here in-house to make that last courtesy check that your cell phones have been turned off. And of course, for our internet viewers who are watching us, you can send questions or comments at any time simply emailing us at speaker@heritage.org. And we will be posting the program later today on our website for everyone's future reference as well. Hosting our discussion today is Charlotte Florence, who is a research associate for economic freedom in Africa and the Middle East, part of our Douglas and Sarah Allison Center for Foreign Policy Studies. In this capacity, she concentrates on economic freedom, democratic institutions, development, and security cooperation in the areas of Africa and the Middle East. Before joining us, she was a research fellow for international security and foreign policy issues on the Federal Financial Management Subcommittee of the Senate Homeland Security and Government Affairs Committee. You can always tell importance by the longer the title. She previously worked in Kenya with a local Catholic Relief Services partner organization, St. Joseph Shelter of Hope, as a program development assistant. Here she concentrated on sustainable alternative livelihood projects for individuals who tested HIV positive, part of the president's emergency plan for AIDS relief in Africa. She also has been part of a business enterprises that managed small-scale production projects in East Africa. She has been in United Kingdom, also had significant time in Colombia and Morocco and Turkey. She holds a master's degree in conflict and security development from the War Studies Department at King's College London, and her bachelor's degree in international relations from the University of Southern California. Please join me in welcoming my colleague, Charlotte Florence. Charlotte?
Thank you, John, and thank you all for joining us today. Recent events in the Gulf of Guinea, including the kidnapping of two Americans last month by pirates, have focused international attention on the issue of surging piracy in West Africa. While piracy off the coast of Somalia has dominated the focus on anti-piracy efforts in recent years, the trends are changing. In the recent Hollywood film, Captain Phillips, we were reminded of how poorly prepared ships were just a few years ago to defend against armed pirate intruders. I'm especially excited to have John Clark Levin join us today to discuss his recent book titled Private Anti-Piracy Navies, How Warships for Hire Are Changing Maritime Security. John Clark Levin is a writer currently pursuing a master's degree in public policy at the Harvard Kennedy School. He received the 2010 Arthur R. Adams Fellowship at the Keck Center for International and Strategic Studies, researching private maritime security. He also served as the Harrison Fellow at the Salvatore Center for the Study of Individual Freedom in the Modern World in 2011. He was the winner of the 2010 Eric Brendel Collegiate Journalism Award and has written for publications including the Wall Street Journal, the Daily Caller, City Journal Online, and the Southern Economics Journal. If you're interested in purchasing his book, you can find it on Amazon or use one of the order forms in our lobby today. Please welcome John Clark Levin.
Thank you so much, Charlotte. So, taking a step back here, I'd like to frame the problem that drove the creation of the private maritime security sector in the first place. For 20 years, starting in the early 1990s, Somalia had a very low-level piracy problem. So that would usually take the form of small fishing boats being robbed or ships passing very close to the coast having robbers come aboard, steal watches from the crew or cash from the ship's safe. Incidents that would usually result in losses of a few thousand dollars at most. But in 2008, for reasons that remain somewhat unclear, that low-level piracy problem spiraled out of control very suddenly. And the method of attacks shifted from low-level robbery to hijacking of whole ships. And the reason this was possible in Somalia was that, unlike just about anywhere else in the world, there was a long, lawless coast to which pirates could take hijacked ships, knowing that they were safe from the reach of law enforcement. Just about anywhere else in the world, if pirates hijack a ship and take it to the coast, the local police can arrive right away and free the hostages, and that would be the end of it. But off Somalia, that was not the case. I don't have a map behind me, but to put it in perspective, since this really does not jump out at you from looking at a globe, the coast of Somalia is roughly as long as the United States' eastern seaboard. It's huge. And the weak government in Somalia has been unable to police that vast expanse. So as a result, the pirates became more and more daring as they saw that they could carry out these hijackings and then ransom the hull, cargo, and crew all together for first six-figure sums, then seven-figure sums, and ultimately eight-figure sums. And as this cycle of ransoms fueled more and more aggressive attacks, the problem spread further out to sea. So it used to be almost within sight of land, and then within a year or two, pirates were attacking hundreds of miles out into the ocean and eventually close to the coast of India. So this encompassed a threat area larger than Western Europe. So international navies understood that this was a grave threat to shipping lanes that carry much of the world's oil and very valuable trade between Europe and Asia as it passes through the Suez Canal, down the Red Sea, through the Gulf of Aden, and then through the Indian Ocean on its way to Asia. So three major international task forces were sent to the Gulf of Aden and the surrounding waters to try to suppress the pirate threat. But unfortunately, regular warships are a tool rather ill-suited to suppressing piracy. There's a fundamental economic mismatch there. Here's the trouble. Warships are very, very powerful and consequently very, very expensive, so they're few in number. They have sophisticated anti-missile, anti-aircraft, anti-submarine capabilities. But that means that when they're on anti-piracy duty, most of those other capabilities are essentially wasted. Taxpayers are paying for a lot of capacity and capability that go unused. By contrast, the pirates operate in fast motorboats called skiffs, which can be between several hundred and several thousand dollars. And as a result, they're very, very numerous. So the analogy I like to draw is of goalkeepers in soccer. Picture the best goalkeeper in the world, Iker Casillas. Even Casillas couldn't successfully defend the goal against 10 seven-year-olds taking shots on goal simultaneously. Even the best goalkeeper couldn't keep all those balls out of the net. And that's essentially what we saw with regular navies. Even though they had many spectacular successes, they just couldn't keep all the balls out of the net. So that drove the shipping industry and the maritime insurance industry to look to private security to fill that gap between what the navies could provide and the security they needed. So starting in 2008, very early on in this, Blackwater, the firm very well known for operations on land in Iraq and Afghanistan, purchased a former NOAA research ship and converted it to use as an armed escort and tried hiring it out to shipping companies looking for protection in the Gulf of Aden. But at that time, Blackwater's name was tainted by the Nisour Square shooting in Baghdad, and the shipping industry was just too nervous. They didn't want to associate themselves with that scandal. But other companies, newer companies, less known companies, realized that the failure of Blackwater to make that model work didn't reflect an underlying problem with the economic model. It was just that scandal, that uncertainty, that taint. So several other companies bought excess patrol boats, surplus Coast Guard vessels from other navies around the world, converted those to act as private escorts, and started hiring them out to provide anti-piracy security. By 2010 and 11, there was growing pressure for flag states, that is to say the countries that have their flag flying at the back of a merchant ship, to allow firearms on board. So instead of having escort vessels sailing alongside, they wanted to be able to have armed guards actually embarked on the merchant ships, because that was cheaper for the shipping industry. By 2011, several major maritime nations had allowed that. They had revised their firearms laws. So by 2012, actually a majority of major merchant ships in the high-risk area had armed private security of some form. We saw Somali piracy plummet as a result, largely as a result, in that region. But over the past year, piracy has been surging in the Gulf of Guinea, off West Africa. And the brand of piracy there is rather different from the Somali model. The Somali model was hijacking whole ships for ransom, whereas the signature attack off West Africa is oil theft. So there, pirates target tankers that are sailing along due to the petroleum resources in that region. They send a boat to hijack the ship. And then they have their own small tanker, which rendezvous with the victim tanker. They connect essentially umbilical cables between the two, siphon out several million dollars worth of oil, and then fence that oil on Nigeria's thriving black market for oil. And the reason that brand of piracy is even more troubling to the shipping industry than the Somali kind is that the pirates who are just in it for the oil really don't have any incentive to keep the crews safe. That has resulted in greater violence and aggression, more fatalities among crew members. And so that is really keeping the shipping industry up at night, trying to find private solutions to that. And the other complication is that the countries around the Gulf of Guinea are generally quite hostile to the use of private security. So they don't allow embarked guards into their waters, which means that if a merchant ship has embarked guards, it must stop at the 12-mile limit and lighter the guards off so they can pass through and not fall afoul of local laws. The private maritime security industry sees that as something that may make private escorts more viable for that market. And then the third threat that is keeping people up at night, in addition to Somali piracy and West African piracy, is the threat of maritime terrorism. In 2000, there was the attack on the USS Cole in Yemen, which was a case of a small explosives-laden boat just driving up to an American destroyer and detonating. 2 years later, a similar attack targeted a French tanker called the Limburg, and then in 2010 there was an attack on a Japanese tanker called the M-Star. And because these attacks have been limited in number, only about three in the last little more than a decade, some people have been overconfident. They've thought, okay, maritime terrorism is probably not much of a threat at this point. But we've seen over the past several years, Al-Qaeda has been shifting its center of gravity from the fighting in Pakistan and Afghanistan toward Africa through its affiliates in Libya and Algeria and Nigeria and Mali. There's the Boko Haram group in Nigeria, the Al-Shabaab affiliate in Somalia. And Al-Qaeda has repeatedly threatened merchant shipping. We know they have ambitions to do that because the economic disruption that would be caused by such attacks is much greater than that caused by piracy. Because if a ship is merely hijacked, it's out of commission for several months during the ransom negotiation process, but fundamentally everything stays intact. By contrast, if pirates were successful in sinking a major supertanker, that could have catastrophic fallout in the maritime shipping industry, the maritime insurance industry. Premiums would skyrocket even further. And so that's something that the shipping industry is very keen to avoid. And the private escorts, which I focus on in my book, as opposed to the embarked guards, are a particularly appealing solution or countermeasure for the threat of maritime terrorism. Because the two attacks, piracy versus terrorism, have very different tactical models. With piracy, the pirates have to sail alongside the merchant ship and time their movement to come right alongside the hull and then throw up ladders or grappling hooks, scramble on board, take the crew at gunpoint. And during that approach and boarding process, the pirates are very vulnerable. And then once they do succeed in capturing a ship, if they do, the time between that capture occurring and actually getting back to Somalia can be several days. By contrast, with a maritime terror attack, it could be a matter of a few minutes between identifying a suspicious boat in the distance and that boat detonating against the hull of the victim ship. That requires a much more aggressive defensive posture. So instead of just having embarked guards to try to scare the pirates away, it requires having a more robust defense capable of engaging targets at a distance and neutralizing them. So in general, this has been quite a challenge for international law. We have not seen anything amounting to so-called private navies since the time of the British East India Company. And at that time, it was perfectly acceptable to just hang captured pirates by the yardarm. There was no sense of pirates having human rights that needed to be respected. But now that's the prevailing norm in international law. Pirates are considered criminals who are deserving of formal prosecution. And so that has left international law huffing and puffing, trying to catch up now that we see private civilian vessels acting in the capacity of warships. And it has been unclear, for example, what circumstances are appropriate for civilians to use lethal force. The prevailing legitimacy model has been self-defense. So unlike regular navies, which can essentially go out and hunt pirates, the private escort vessels have been limited to responding to attacks once they begin. But it's not always clear when you're under attack. It's fairly apparent if pirates are shooting RPGs at you that probably you're under attack. If pirates are shooting AK-47s at you, you're probably under attack. But if pirates are shooting AK-47s into the air near you, you may not be under attack. In that part of the world, even innocent fishermen are usually armed for self-defense. And if they see that a merchant ship is going to run over their nets and destroy their catch, it's been known for innocent fishermen to fire their guns into the air and try to scare away the merchant ship. That could very easily be perceived as an act of piracy and result in use of lethal force. So what we've seen over the past several years is a collaborative effort by governments, NGOs, the shipping industry, the maritime insurance industry, and also the private maritime security industry, trying to establish norms and rules for the use of force. This year, we're seeing coming online the 100 series rules for the use of force, which dictate a process of graduated escalation of force. So what that means is when a suspicious boat approaches, private security forces start by firing flares or using a loud hailer, an acoustic device that can either broadcast verbal warnings in local languages or can play loud, unpleasant pop music. Britney Spears and Christina Aguilera have been actually used for that purpose. And then if those fail to deter a suspicious vessel, then there are to be warning shots into the air over the target, and then warning shots into the water in front of the target. And only if all those things fail to either warn away innocent fishermen or deter would-be pirates, only then is private security authorized to use lethal force. Also, we've seen great regulatory improvements over the past couple of years. There's now the ISO 28007 framework, which establishes accreditation procedures, and that is intended to help potential clients of private maritime security companies, prospective hirers, to discern which are the competent companies and which are the incompetent companies. So that's done a good job of helping them distinguish which are reputable. And so now where we stand looking to the future is that as this industry is adapting to the growing threat off West Africa and potential threats in the future, it has maintained. In previous conflicts, there had been private maritime security, such as piracy in the Strait of Malacca. But after that piracy subsided, the private security industry more or less dissolved. But what we're seeing here, which is quite striking, is that a lot of the same companies that operated to combat one threat off Somalia are now shifting to the West African threat. So there's a continuity there, which suggests that this industry will be around for the long haul. The very day I finalized copy on my book, to my mixed relief and chagrin, Somalia signed a contract with a Dutch private maritime security company to organize and operate a private anti-piracy coast guard for Somalia. And so we're seeing now, in addition to shipping companies hiring private security, it's also nation states that are doing so. So that portends more naval privatization in the future for cases where the desired application is not a blue water navy capable of sinking submarines and shooting down missiles, but rather policing waters against piracy, smuggling, human trafficking, or enforcing resource rights if developing countries are unable to do so. So that's essentially what the outlook is at this point, and I welcome your questions and further discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, John, for that insightful presentation. I think we all look forward to reading your book. I'm sure there are quite a few questions from the audience. If I could remind you all to please state your name and affiliation before you ask a question, and then to make it a question, not a statement. I think I'll take the liberty of asking the first one. It looks like you're kind of going further into more of the territorial water issues and
yes.
How, so you have different laws pertaining to different territorial waters. Do you see, I think there was recently an announcement about a maritime security center in Cameroon that apparently West African regional body is going to help establish something that will address some of these issues. Have you heard, are you optimistic about this? Is this something you've been following?
I have not been following that very closely, but from what I have seen of that, there is a desire among West African nations to stamp out the problem. The trouble is they have, for nationalistic reasons, been reluctant to allow private security in, because that's essentially admitting their own inability to police their territorial waters. And also, by forbidding foreign private security contractors, that has forced the shipping industry to bribe local security forces to act as their protectors within territorial waters. So there is an economic incentive for these countries not to be too aggressive in how they deal with the problem. But I do see sincerity on their part.
Yeah, I'm Commander Renee Liberty from the U.S. Navy Staff. I deal with all the African engagement for the Navy Staff here in Washington, and coordinate with a lot of the activities that go out, both out of Naval Forces Africa and Naples, as well as a lot of the country teams. The one question I had is specifically, you were talking about the interest of a lot of the security companies moving from off the coast of Somalia towards West Africa. What kind of activity are they looking at? Because, again, with the significant restrictions, with the exception of Benin, everybody's saying we don't allow armed personnel on ships, and we have all sorts of other legal restrictions about the ability to operate. And again, with corruption and some of the other problems associated with enforcement of laws, how do these security companies look at being able to operate in that region with such, as we know in some countries, and again, in the West African or the Gulf of Guinea situation, we know it's primarily a Nigerian problem. How do you basically see these companies operating when a lot of the security that's coming out of Nigeria is they don't like the competition?
Yes.
Basically. So how are they going to effectively be able to reproduce what has been going on off the coast of Somalia effectively off the coast of, basically in the Gulf of Guinea?
Thanks for that question. So there are essentially three models of security which private companies can provide off West Africa. The first would be private escorts, which are able to operate up to the 12-mile limit and no further. That's already going on to some extent. Also, embarked guards, which are able to operate up to the 12-mile limit and no further. That has still generated demand. There is demand for those services. Another possibility, which is, I believe, growing at the moment, is for unarmed collaboration between private maritime security companies and local security forces. So what we've seen lately is companies operating the escort vessels, but without carrying any of their own weapons past the 12-mile limit, they then take on board local security forces and use those as the muscle, so to speak. But that allows the private security companies to leverage their own expertise at defensive maneuvers and maintain their relationships with the client merchant ships.
Dion Nissenbaum from the Wall Street Journal. I'm wondering what you think about the PMPF model, because there are some people that argue that what you need to do is choke off the pirates on land and cut off their supply routes, and whether that's a viable option on West Africa.
Well, I think just about everyone in this agrees that private security is really only a Band-Aid solution. Almost all of the private security executives that I interviewed for the book admitted exactly that. So there's agreement that stopping pirates on land is really the way to go. The trouble is, of course, how do we do that? And off East Africa and West Africa, those are two somewhat different conditions. Off Somalia, In that country, we see that the main issue is just law and order on the coast. We need to have law enforcement be able to reach the safe havens so that pirates don't have any place where they can conduct ransom negotiations with impunity. off West Africa. And with that problem, I see the oil market being more of an issue there. Nigeria faces really a startlingly bad problem with oil theft and sabotage that's estimated to account for about 10% of its daily output, which is either stolen or destroyed or burned or otherwise misappropriated. So if we can clamp down on that problem and the very sophisticated criminal enterprises that support oil theft in Nigeria, I think that would be the most productive way to diminish piracy there.
Hi, James Velasquez, a freelance journalist. Can you talk a bit about what organization the pirates have? Is it a concerted effort? Is it something, a network that we're aware of? Or is this small groups kind of operating at first come, first serve, first chance they see to take something, they do it? And do those networks present any opportunities to kind of nip the problem in the bud or strike first? Does that make sense?
Yes. Well, it appears that the West African pirates have more of a centralized hierarchical system than the East African pirates do. But that said, it would not be accurate to characterize them as having truly centralized governance. There are several pirate gangs that have been identified on both coasts, which have some centralization of resources, and the ransom proceeds flow up along those chains. But at the same time, on an operational level, I don't think there are very good prospects for nipping the problem in the bud, simply because the pirate overlords in the Somali interior are safely ensconced in places that are hard to reach. And going after them with military force would basically risk another Black Hawk Down, and that's not a prospect that is palatable to really either military or political leadership in any of the countries capable of doing so.
Hi, I'm Felipe Torres from the Africa Center for Strategic Studies. I was hoping you could go into a little bit more explanation about how the model of private maritime security corporations going within the 12-mile zone and then bringing on in-country security forces, is that what you said?
Or yes.
Security. Could you explain a little bit more or provide a couple of examples?
So this model is still in its very early stages, but essentially what it would entail is a merchant ship sailing in company with a private escort vessel, which would probably be unarmed. They reach the 12-mile limit. At that point, they take on board a security team from the local country, usually Nigeria, that would have another boat that then loads those onto the private escort. And then with the local security on board, the merchant ship and the escort would proceed to their destination, such as an oil terminal or some petroleum infrastructure within the 12-mile limit.
Is that a state security force, or is that a private security force that they take out?
Those are state security forces at various levels. So there's private hiring out of public forces. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
I actually have another question.
Sure.
I'm trying to remember the parties involved, but I can't. I think recently, as in within the last year, a couple of years, there was an incident between, I think, an Italian security company and, was it Indian fishermen?
Yes, yes.
So looking at that incident, I was actually just last week looking for some articles talking about how it has evolved since then, or what actually ended up happening, and then two, an analysis of the circumstances and the outcome under the new the proposed regime from like the series that you mentioned, the ISO 28007.
Yes.
Just looking at that incident with these new frameworks in mind, would it have changed? How have these been affected?
So you're referring to the incident of the Enrique Alexia, which was an Italian tanker, which was actually not carrying private security. It was carrying active duty Italian Marines, acting as a vessel protection detachment. As they were passing through India's exclusive economic zone, the Marines on board perceived a threat from a nearby fishing vessel. There was a volley of gunfire, and that led to deaths of a couple of the fishermen. As a result, the Indian authorities caught up with the tanker and arrested the security forces, who were active duty Marines, and they were then taken to jail in India and ultimately charged with murder. This led to an international incident. The Italians fought hard to get their Marines back with the promise that once it was time for them to actually stand trial, they would be sent back to India. So eventually India relented, said, okay, you can have the Marines back. They returned to Italy. And then when India said, okay, we're ready for the trial, send the Marines on back, Italy said, oh, sorry, we're not going to do that. And India was furious about that, and quite a bit of a diplomatic spat. Eventually they relented, and the Marines were sent back to India. But looking to the larger implications of that incident then, that highlights the danger of having private security operating in areas where innocent civilians can be shot, because especially in the case of private security, it's unclear who would have jurisdiction over them in that case. So for example, if we have a private escort vessel, which is owned by a company registered in the UK, crewed by Ukrainian nationals, and flagged to, say, Cyprus, that's three flag states that might be able to exercise jurisdiction in the case of an incident. Now, if that vessel shoots innocent fishermen who are Indian nationals but working for a fishing company registered in Thailand and flagged to Panama, suddenly we have six states all competing to exercise jurisdiction. And the trouble is, those states may have very different interests in how severely they would treat the perpetrators. The flag state of the private escort would probably have strong incentive to let them off quite easily. By contrast, the state of origin of the slain fishermen might want to execute them, considering the private security pirates themselves. So with a tension that great, there is grave potential for an international incident were something like that to occur. Fortunately, there have been very few incidents in which private security has been known to have killed civilians. And fortunately, among private escorts, there have been no documented instances of that to date. And that goes along with a perfect defensive record in which no ship protected by armed private security has been successfully hijacked. And all through the 2 years I was writing the book, I would be nervous looking through piracy-related news each morning to see whether I would have to scrub that assertion out of every place it appears in the book. But that's held up for 5 years now, which I think is actually quite a remarkable result.
Morning. Ed Verona, independent consultant. Two questions. One, you haven't addressed the possibility of terrorism involving passenger vessels. And I think of the Achille Lauro.
Yes.
Going back further. In the early 1960s, there was a Portuguese passenger ship that was hijacked by political dissidents. Became a celebrated incident. And I wonder if you could say anything about what measures could be taken to protect those vessels. Secondly, there was an incident in the recent past involving a Russian vessel in which the Russian military intervened. They took control of the vessel, and I understand that there may have been one or two of the hijackers were killed, but the others were put into an open boat and just sent off. Is there any question about the obligations of either private navies or official navies to protect or to care for hijackers who are captured in the process, and what do they do with them if they come from essentially failed states?
Thanks for both of those questions. Addressing the first part first, the image on the cover of my book, which should be in your flyers, is actually taken from a passenger ship. So what we've seen is passenger ships actually being a significant market for private escorts because they don't want to frighten passengers by having embarked guards with Kevlar and assault rifles strolling the promenade deck. That's bad for business. So better, they find, to have rather discreet escort vessels that can just sail in company and not frighten the passengers, and also give the defensive forces the tactical flexibility to engage potential threats at a distance to hopefully prevent gunfire, if it occurs, from imperiling passengers. As to the second part of your question, that was about the prospect of
obligations.
Yes, thank you. So that's something I consider at some length in the book, and that's something that remains unclear under international law because these incidents are occurring in international waters. So although domestic governments may have obligations to pirates with their regular navies, it's unclear whether those obligations apply to pirates who may surrender to private security forces. Thinking to the Russian incident, there was a vessel called the Moscow University, which was hijacked, and there are two stories actually on that. One, the official story is that the pirates were set adrift in a boat. The other story is that the pirates were summarily executed, and it's not clear quite what happened, but suffice to say, I don't think the Russians are particularly conscientious about the human rights of pirates. At the other extreme, during the first several years of this epidemic, Britain's Royal Navy was under orders from the government in London not to arrest any pirates who might surrender to them because it was feared that if they did so, they would first have to be taken back to the UK for trial, and if they set foot on UK soil there, they could claim rights as refugees or claim asylum and then have a path to citizenship. So that was obviously an absurd result. And under withering criticism, eventually that catch and release policy, as it was called, was overturned. But you're right, there has been a great challenge for countries trying to sort out what obligations they have. The United States winds up taking prisoners to federal court, try them in Norfolk, Virginia, and on one hand, that is a solution that is consistent with the rule of law and what our country stands for, but at the same time, federal court in Norfolk, Virginia is used to trying white-collar fraudsters and extortionists and child pornographers and racketeers. They have really very little experience dealing with crimes on the high seas on the other side of the world concerning citizens who are of another country who have never set foot in the United States and may have never even set foot on an American vessel until they were captured. So that is a challenge for courts like American or German courts, trying to balance their obligations to the suspected pirates with the deficiencies in evidence gathering that will inevitably be manifest when the crime occurred in those circumstances so far away.
Can I follow up?
Sure.
In the aftermath, following the Russian vessel incident, have there been any other attacks on Russian vessels or Russian ships or ships carrying Russian cargoes?
I believe there has been a small number of them, yes. But to my knowledge, and I'm trying to think, to my knowledge, none have been successfully hijacked since then.
Hi, Doug Brooks. I'm a consultant these days, and I apologize because I missed the first part of your talk. But you mentioned that no ship protected by private security has ever been captured, which is true, but it also doesn't matter now whether the private security that's protecting the ship is former Navy SEALs or Bangladeshi farmers with AKs. Essentially, all you need to have is private security. So doesn't this portend a dumbing down of the private security that's going to be working on these ships?
Thanks for your question. In 2011, as many countries were loosening their firearms laws to allow private security on board in embarked teams, that was a significant worry because many companies were entering the industry trying to cash in on this private security boom. But it was very easy to do so without having the proper qualifications. So we were seeing companies basically buying Kevlar and assault weapons online, setting up a fancy website and hiring themselves out with absolutely no real experience. And so that's what prompted the accreditation regimes like the ISO 28007 standard, which are intended to provide a rigorous and concrete framework against which these companies can be objectively and independently judged, so that if it is Bangladeshi farmers with AK-47s, that will be at least clear to prospective clients so they know if they are hiring that company, they're getting what they paid for. So, yes, some companies have been perfectly willing to hire substandard private security to save on their own costs, because they know that just by checking that box, they're saving on insurance premiums. And early on in this conflict, before the accreditation regimes started coming forward, that was a problem for insurance companies because they were essentially being taken advantage of. They were having people affirm, yes, oh, we have private security, but it might be two guys with no experience. Does that answer?
James Jeffers, consultant. Two questions, quick ones. One, are there any conflicting territorial waters claims that are causing confusion over the issues in East or West Africa? And are there any new technologies emerging in anti-piracy weapons?
So to make sure I understand the first part of that question correctly, are you saying cases where there's dispute over who controls particular territorial waters?
Which nation state? East China Sea, South China Sea, are examples, but I don't know if it's...
Yes. To my knowledge, none of those sorts of issues are present in the current hotspots off East or West Africa. As to new technologies, that has been quite a boom over the last few years. It was especially strong in 2009 and 10. When it was very clear that the problem was severe, but before actual firearms were legalized for so many merchant ships. So we saw many different kinds of countermeasures floated as possibilities. Some ships have electric fences installed around the railing, so if pirates try to scramble on board, they get zapped. Another one is acoustic devices. The long-range acoustic device, or LRAD, fires a focused beam of high-intensity sound that is supposed to make it very unpleasant for anyone approaching the vessel with intent to hijack it. Unfortunately, there was an incident where the LRAD was used by unarmed private security, and they were trying to focus it on incoming pirates. It didn't work. The private security actually jumped overboard and fled. And so Lloyd's List punned in the wake of that incident that the LRAD may not be a sound investment. So at this point, as of 2013, generally the LRADs are not considered effective, just because if there's a payday in the 5 to 6 figures for individual pirates out there in the distance, they can probably be induced to put their fingers in their ears or stuff with cotton or something. In other words, it's just not enough of a deterrent. Another possibility that is in development is focused energy weapons. And I know Oman was working with developing those for maritime uses. The UAE has done so as well. But those have not actually been rolled out operationally yet. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, John Clark, for joining us today at the Heritage Foundation. I hope you all purchase his book. I think you'll, from this kind of glimpse at it, you know, it's very interesting.
Yeah, I had hoped to have them available for sale today. The book was formally released a couple weeks ago, but apparently they're still cooling on a windowsill somewhere like freshly baked pies. So you've got order forms if you're so inclined. It's also on Amazon.
All right.
Thank you.